Today we will be discussing the topic distributed computation and its paradigm. What is distributed computing, or you can say computation? It is a field of computer science that studies distributed system. It is useful to identify the basic patterns or models of distributed application and classify the details according to these models. So, here we are going to study about the different computation models, how we are arranging the architecture of a distributed system, what are the different ways in which we can transit information or messages from one system to another in a distributed system is a distributed computation paradigm. Or you can say distributed computing. Characteristics that distinguish distributed application from conventional application running on a single machine are inter-process communication. So the first difference comes here. A distributed application requires the participation of two or more independent entities or the processes. To do so, the process must have the ability to exchange data among themselves. Event synchronization. The second difference is distributed application, the sending and the receiving of data among the participants of a distributed application must be synchronized. So here comes the two basic requirements or the characteristics of distributed application. That means there should be a mechanism for inter-process communication, as well as there should be the synchronization of an event. That means there should be some notion of time on the basis of which we are going to synchronize our events or processes. The first method or the first computation paradigm was message passing paradigm. It is the most fundamental paradigm for distributed application. A process sends a message representing a request. Here we can say a process A initiate a message and send it to the process B. So it is a request to send a message. The message is delivered to a receiver which processes the request and sends a message in response. So when process B receives that message A, it reads the message, processes the message and sends the required response back to the process A as again a message. In turn, the reply may trigger a further request which lead to a subsequent reply and so forth. That means this message, when it will be received by process A, it may trigger A to again send a message to B, and so on. The process will go on until the communication terminates. So the basic operations are send and receive for connection oriented communication. The operations connect and disconnect are also required. Paradigm is client server paradigm. It is the best known paradigm for network applications. One process, the server, plays the role of service provider, which waits passively for the arrival of request. The other process is client, that issues specific request to the server and waits for its response. That means there are two basic entities. One is the server and another node is the client. Client, the node which requests for some work, for some application, and the server which gives the response for the query of the client. Simple in concept, client-server model provides an efficient abstraction for the delivery of services. Operations required include those for a server process to listen for and to accept request, and for a client process to issue request and accept responses. By assigning asymmetric roles to the two sides, event synchronization is simplified. The server process waits for the request and client in turn waits for the responses. Many internet services are client-server applications. These services are often known by the protocol that the application implements. The well-known internet services include Hypertext Text Transfer Protocol, HTTP, File Transfer Protocol, FTP, Domain Name Service, DNS, Finger, Gopher, etc. This is the basic client-server model, conceptual diagram. This is a server and this is a client. These are the clients. Here you can see this client host sends a request message for a certain process. It has been received by the server stub and is processed by that, reaches that particular process. The processing is done and the response may be sent back to the client. So client always sends the request and receives the responses, which is not shown over here in the figure. It is just showing that client is issuing a request service and server is receiving them. Next paradigm is peer-to-peer system architecture. It is same as the client-server model. The only difference is here is that in the client-server model, one process is always acting as the server and another process will always acting as the client. So there is a defined responsibilities of the processes. The one which is server will always act as server and the one which is client will always be the client. Whereas in the peer-to-peer network, each and every node is equally privileged. That means as per the requirement, any process can be the server and any process can be the client. So what is written over here? In this, computer resources and services are directly exchanged between computer systems. The participating process play equal roles and with equivalent capabilities and responsibilities. That means each one is capable of performing both the processes. Whereas the client-server paradigm is an ideal model for a centralized network service. The peer-to-peer paradigm is more appropriate for applications such as instant messaging, peer-to-peer file transfers, video conferencing and collaborative work. Next comes the message system paradigm. The message system or message-oriented middleware is an elaboration of the basic message passing system that we have just studied. In this paradigm, a message system serves an intermediary among the server separate independent processes. So we can say there is a middleware, or we can say a front-end processor type system is there. A queuing mechanism sends the message to the message system. It will queue up the message, it will keep the message, store the message, and as the receiver will be free, it will send the message to the receiver for processing. In this paradigm, a message system serves as an intermediate among the independent processes. The message system acts as a switch for messages. So it is just acting as a switch, or we can say what we have studied in message switching. It is just like message switching, through which process exchange message asynchronously in a decoupled manner. A sender deposits a message with the message system, which forward it to a message queue associated with each receiver. Each receiver will be having a message queue. Whenever there is a queue is vacant, the message system will transfer the message to the queue of the respective receiver, which forward it to a message queue associated with each receiver. Once a message is sent, the sender is free to move on to other task. Okay, so when that message will be sent to the queue, the sender can again send a message to the message system. The first method or the first computation paradigm was message passing paradigm. It is the most fundamental paradigm for distributed application. A process sends a message representing a request. Here we can say a process A initiate a message and send it to the process B. So it is a request to send a message. The message is delivered to a receiver which processes the request and sends a message in response. So when process B receives that message A, it reads the message, processes the message and sends the required response back to the process A as again a message. In turn, the reply may trigger a further request which lead to a subsequent reply and so forth. That means this message, when it will be received by process A, it may trigger A to again send a message to B, and so on. The process will go on until the communication terminates. So the basic operations are send and receive for connection oriented communication. The operations connect and disconnect are also required. Next, process A, this is process B. Process A will be sending a procedure call having argument 1 and 2. It will be processed by process B while receiving. Then it will again send a procedure 2 with argument 1. Then that procedure call will initiate an activity in process A and the response will be sent as procedure call 3. Having certain arguments. So the process goes on, and this is the another method of communication in network programming model. The idea of applying object orientation of distributed application is a natural extension of the object oriented software development. With the development of object oriented system, there was a need of having certain paradigm of distributed system computation which are based on object oriented programming. So there are various object-oriented paradigm for computation, such as remote method invocation, network services, object request broker, object spaces. First one is remote method invocation. It is the object-oriented equivalent of remote method call, or we can say remote procedure call. In this model, a process invokes the method in an object which may reside in a remote host. As with RPC, arguments may be passed with the invocation. Here we can see a process 1 uses an RMI, remote method invocation, and invoke method 1 and 2, or we can say a remote object in method 1 and 2 for certain request. Next is the network service paradigm. In this paradigm, service providers register themselves with the directory servers on a network. Here we are seeing this is the directory. This is the service requester. First it will register itself on the directory service. After getting a reference, it will use that reference to contact with the service object. Let us see. A process desiring a particular service contacts the directory server at the runtime, and if the service is available, will be provided a reference to the service. Using that reference, the process interacts with the service. This paradigm is essentially an extension of the remote method call paradigm. The difference is that service objects are registered with a global directory service, allowing them to be looked up and accessed by service requester on a federated network. Java Genie technology is based on this paradigm only. Next is the object request broker paradigm. In the object request broker paradigm, an application issues a request to an object request broker ORB, which directs the request to an appropriate object that provides the desired service. It closely resembles the remote method invocation model in its support for remote object access. The difference is that the object request broker in this paradigm functions as a middleware, which allows an application as an object requester to potentially access multiple remote or local objects. The request broker may also function as a mediator for heterogeneous objects. It is not necessary that objects may be of same type. They can be different, they can be from different sources, they can have different protocols, they can have different configurations, or they can be programmed into different languages also. Allowing interactions among objects implemented using different APIs and or running on different platforms. So here we can see it is a requester object. It requests a service through object request broker for a particular object on certain other process or system. At a time, it can request multiple servers having of different objects, as it can access different objects from different sources using multiple requests. It is the basis for object management groups CORBA, Common Object Request Broker Architecture, that we will study in case study also. So if the CORBA is based on ORB architecture, then certain other toolkits or architectures are available, such as InPrice Busy Broker. You can refer this link for detail. Java's Interface Development Language, Java IDL, that you can refer this link for further study. Orbix Iona or TAO from the object computing. This is the link for that. The next computation paradigm is object space paradigm. The most abstract of the object-oriented paradigm, the object space assumes the existence of logical entities known as object spaces. Here you are seeing there are very, this is the ellipse or the circle is showing representing an object space. The participants of an application converge in a common object space. That means the requester, the service providers, which are having various objects to which people may ask for a certain request or responses. Certain those objects are pooled in a collective space known as object space. Provider places object as entries into an object space, and requesters who subscribes to the space access the entries. So here, whosoever is the requester, whosoever has a certain request, they have to first subscribe them for a particular event or a process, and the provider will provide the their objects into the object space. So whosoever wants to access the particular object has to subscribe for their object in the object space, and then they can directly contact that particular or read that particular object or the service that they wanted to access. In addition to the abstraction provided by other paradigm, the object space paradigm provide a virtual space or meeting room among providers and requesters of network resources or objects. This abstraction hides the detail involved in resource or object lookup needed in paradigm, such as remote method invocation, object request broker, or network services. So here we do not need any middleware system. If you have subscribed for that particular object, you will receive that particular object through the object space. Then comes the component based technologies such as Microsoft COM, DCOM, Common Object Model, Distributed Common Object Model, Java Bean, Enterprise Java Bean are also based on distributed object paradigm, as components are essentially specialized packaged objects designed to interact with each other through standardized interfaces. In addition, application servers popular for enterprise applications are middleware facilities which provide access to objects or components, IBM WebSphere. There are many, these are computation, we can see these are the computation paradigm which you might have used them, because this is a subject that has been, that has came in the 90s, and till then we have progressed a lot. So you all might have used WebSphere or Unix system or COM and DCOM, CORBA technologies, Enterprise Java Bean or RMI systems. They all have been used by you, so you might be knowing about them, how they are working. Next is the mobile agent paradigm. A mobile agent is a transportable program or object. In this model, an agent is launched from an originating host. Agent travels from the host to host according to an itinerary that it carries. At each stop, the agent accesses the necessary resources or services and performs the necessary tasks to accomplish its mission. It is like a ring topology, where a token has been sent. So here object is generated and it goes from node to node, and at each node, if it requires some resources from that node or services, it will fetch them, it will accomplish its mission, and then it will move further till it completes its mission. The paradigm offers the abstraction for a transportable program or object. In lieu of message exchanges, data is carried by the program object as the program is transported among the participants. Okay, so instead of getting messages, it is taking the data, and wherever it requires the processing has to be done, it goes to that particular node, the processing is done, and then it will collect the result and goes to another node for further processing, and so and so. Commercial packages which support the mobile agent paradigm includes इलेक्ट्रिक आईटीएस, कॉन्कॉर्डिया सिस्टम, आईबीएम, एग्लेट सिस्टम. यू कैन विजिट दीज लिंक्स फॉर फर्दर डिटेल्स एज दे आर नॉट इन योर स्लेब एज दे आर नॉट इन बिलो अबव. Such detail is not required at this particular instance. The collaborative application paradigm. In this model, process participate in a collaborative session as a group. Each participating process may contribute input to part or the entire group. Process may go using multicasting to send data to all part or a group, or they may use a virtual sketchpad or whiteboards which allow each participant to read and write data to a shared display. First see this method. It is message based group bear paradigm. So a group of processes has been created and they can transfer messages among themselves and receive responses by message passing or a collaborative session. Here it is a whiteboard or based group bear paradigm where there is a scratch board on which we can write any request, we can display any data to be read by a group of systems commonly. To varying degrees, these paradigms provide abstractions that insulate the developers from detail of inter-process communication and event synchronization, allowing the programmer to concentrate on the bigger picture of the application itself. So this is what the basic aim of distributed system is, that is transparency, hiding the internal detail that how the processing is done, how the data is transferred. It always makes us feel that I am the only user of all the resources, every resource is available on my system. The naive user will never be known that from where these services are coming. A person sitting on machine will always feel like as if entire thing is available on that particular machine only on which he is working, but he does not know through internet, through intranet, through the mobile computing, these resources that he is using are not available on his machine. They are being fetched from different instances, different machines, and made available to him in a distributed shared computation. In choosing a paradigm or tool for an application, there are trade-offs that should be considered, including overheads, scalability, cross-platform support, and software engineering issues, and that we will study in further units.